Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Exploring English Food and Culture Facebook Live. I had trouble saying that, but never mind.
Do the course, Neil. You'll be all right by the end.
Yeah, I need to work on either teeth or pronunciation, one of the two. I'm joined today by a football team's worth of people. You can see here Chris, the lead educator from the course. Hello, Chris.
Hi, Neil. Hi, everyone.
And Claire, another educator from the course.
Hello.
And in 2 seconds, we're going to be joined by Sally, whom many of you will know already.
Hello.
And Tina is also somewhere around. Let me just find her and bring her in as well. There we go.
Hello!
Okay, so we're all here today, lots of people. So be patient if we have some little technical things as we move around. Anyway, as I said, we're here to talk about our Exploring English Food and Culture course. And for anyone who's on the course, you already know about it. But for anyone who isn't, Chris, can you tell us a little bit about what it's about, who it's for, how much it costs, anything?
It's about food, it's for everyone, and it's free. So okay. It's called Exploring English, Food and Culture. So we talk about food in Britain, but we talk about more than just food, because we use food to talk about the culture of Britain. So we talk about what people eat for breakfast. You might know, for example, the traditional British breakfast, but that lets us talk about what time people have breakfast. Why do they have a big breakfast? Why is the British breakfast so big? Do people still do that? So we talk about what life is like in Britain today, but we use food to talk about that. And also, it's not just about British food, it's about your food too. So all the way through the course, we'll ask you to tell us something about food in your country. Is it the same as in Britain? Do people have the same thing for breakfast, or do they have something different? It's not just about breakfast, though. I keep...
But it is the most important meal of the day, though. So. And we'll be looking at some recipes and some things that people have shared a bit later. So what Chris was saying there about it being about your food, you'll get a chance to see that as well. Claire, tell us a little bit about what's been happening this week on the course.
Well, this week, the question is, what is British food? And I don't want to spoil it too much, but we're looking at some traditional, what people think of when they think of Britain. So think of it like fish and chips and a roast dinner and cakes, toast. But we're also looking at all the international food that British people love to eat and that we love to cook and that we love to go out to restaurants and eat as well. And that's got a big link with immigration to the UK and all the wonderful food that people have brought with them.
Okay, great. I'm going to start by asking everyone who's watching a question, because we've been talking about British food and everything here, but, you know, have you tried it? You know, either in the UK or in your own country, do you have a favourite? Did you like British food? Is there something you like? Sally and Tina, have people been talking about this on the course? Tell me a little bit about what they've been saying.
We're just going to nod, Sam.
Yeah, just nod. It's just really weird talking to Neil and he's not actually here.
Isn't it great?
Don't worry, I'll be back in a second. You know, but people have seen enough of me this week. It's okay for me to be off camera for a little bit.
But so, people, when they talk about British food, they think of the British fry up, don't they, the breakfast. And fish and chips is mentioned quite a lot. And cakes. I came across a lovely comment this week about cake. Someone's like baking, and I suggested they talk to Sally and Claire because they both like baking as well, and we also share scones, don't we, later on in the course?
Or scones, yeah.
Oh, here we go.
Let's not start arguing about Sally's mispronunciation yet. We'll come back to that later.
Sorry, carry on, Tina.
No, that's what I was, because I was also trying to think about, like you said, Claire, about what's British food. And to be honest, my diet for British food is not just British, it's lots of other cuisines. So, mm-hmm. You know, it's...
Well, exactly. It, like Claire said, we don't want to give away.
Oh, sorry.
But yeah. If you do the course, one of the things we talk about is the national dish of Britain. And people might be surprised to find out what the national dish is and also learn how to cook it in the course.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I was just going to say about people commenting on the course about mm-hmm. whether they've tried British food and whether they like it. There seems to be the whole range of people that have tried it and have liked it. And other people haven't tried it but think it might be nice, and then the people who are sure that it's probably not very nice.
Yeah, but I'm surprised by how many people say they like it, because I would think we have a bad reputation for food, unless everybody's just being really polite.
Maybe that's it.
Did you freeze?
Or maybe things have changed. Are you still there, Neil?
I think Neil might not be there. Can I just say that some people mentioned crumpets on the first step as an example of British food, and I was really surprised by that as well. How you would know how far have crumpets travelled, a lovely kind of round, bready, something you pop under the grill and put butter on. I thought that was very British, but it must be famous.
Yeah. And delicious.
We have some comments coming in already from Bal Amor saying, I've never tasted it and I don't have a clue about it. Mm-hmm. You're the perfect candidate for our course then, because by the end of the course, you'll know everything there is to know about British food. So, Premavira Asirem's asking, what's the staple food in the UK? It's a good question. I mean, I think Chris has something probably to say about this. I mean, what is the most fundamental, something that I think everyone, whether they're vegetarian or meat eaters or vegans or anything, eat, that I think comes up a lot in British food? What would you say, Chris?
I think I would probably say bread and potatoes.
Yeah.
Would be the two staples of British food.
I thought that's what you said. Potatoes especially, I think, yeah.
Yeah, the potatoes are so versatile. You can do so many different things. You know, everybody watching will know about fish and chips. So chips, potatoes, mashed potato. We mentioned mashed potato in the course, I think. Potato again. So there are lots of things that we do with potatoes.
Mm-hmm. Baked potatoes.
Baked potatoes.
Jacket potatoes.
Yeah.
It's really the best of all the vegetables.
I'm going to pop out again for a moment and bring Tina back in, because we have a question about one of my favorite foods here, and from Palakorn Satsui. I've tried a mince pie in New Zealand before. Is it British food?
Yummy.
Now, I could talk about pies all day, but I'm not going to. I'm going to let you talk about pies all day. So,
well, first of all, what kind of mince pie, Palakorn?
You think maybe a Christmas mince pie rather than a meat mince pie?
Well, yeah, so a Christmas mince pie is a sweet mince pie. And you can also have a mince pie made with minced meat, so a savoury mince pie, not a sweet one. Tina, tell us how to make mince pies, the Christmas sweet mince pies.
I've only ever really made them once, to be honest, but Sal made some this year, and I think you even, did you share it on the Padlet, Sal?
Yeah, I did. And nice. I went back to Britain for the first time in like 18 months and bought a jar of mincemeat, which is, as Chris said, it's a sweet filling made from dried fruit, and made mince. I made the pastry, which is, so you have a pastry base and a pastry topping, and then you fill it with mincemeat, this sweet. It's like kind of like jam, isn't it?
It's spiced, isn't it? It's
yeah.
Spicy. Well,
like a chutney or something, maybe.
Mm. Yeah.
It's called meat, but it's not meat.
It's very confusing.
Yeah. There is also mincemeat that is meat.
Well, I was going to say, I don't know. I mean, I know that pies, meat pies, are very popular in New Zealand, for sure. So maybe Palakorn can tell us whether they meant
beef mince.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So when they say a pie, is that with pastry or is that with a potato topping?
It's pastry in New Zealand. It's pastry.
Yeah, I don't think. I mean, you know, I don't think things with potato topping really are pies, like shepherd's pie.
Well, shepherd's pie.
That's
called shepherd's pie.
Yeah.
It's not. It's not a real pie.
But it's called jelly pie. Someone's lying.
Mm-hmm. Okay, a few more comments coming up. Let me just move on very quickly. William Highmore is saying, I just purchased English breakfast tea recently.
Well, good choice.
I think we're all tea fans. Is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Yeah. English breakfast. We're all ready.
English breakfast, Assam, Darjeeling, Earl Grey. What's your favourite? Chris, you have a favourite?
My favourite is just everyday tea, builder's tea. Yorkshire tea is what I drink.
Mm-hmm. I like Peely Wally tea.
Peely Wally tea.
What's that?
That's not real.
Peely Wally telly. Well, that's the opposite of Chris's. So I like mine quite milky and not very strong.
That's a Scottish word. Peely Wally. No.
Yeah. Oh, I always said Peely Wally. That's what my dad said.
Peely Wally. Yes. I'm looking particularly Peely Wally today, which is why I'm not on camera. Lots of comments coming in, so I'm just going to pop some up as we go through. Mohammed is saying the most popular British food are fish and chips, tea, and Sunday roast. That's true, very popular, but if you join the course, you'll find that there's a lot more as well. Yep. Hussein is saying, I've always been thinking fish and chips is a great food for breakfast.
Oh, that is a good idea, Hussein. I've never done it.
Hussein, yeah. Uh-huh.
And in fact, someone on the course said they had chips for breakfast that day because it was leftovers from the night before.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, possibly, yeah.
Oh, well, then you could have, what do you call it? Chip butty. Bubble and squeak.
Or chip butty sammy.
A chip butty sarnie, what?
For breakfast.
I think, you know, I'm just going to suggest that maybe you might need to explain the vocabulary there a little to the people watching.
Chip butty, a sandwich. So where I'm from, we say butty a lot instead of sandwich. So two pieces of bread and then the chips in between.
Okay.
But you wouldn't normally have that for breakfast, would you? Or do you have that for breakfast?
I don't think I have. It's not a bad idea.
Well, in parts of Lancashire, I mean, in Wigan, you can have a meat pie between two pieces of bread, like a pie barm, so a pie sandwich.
Wigan butty.
Like we're talking about in New Zealand, but between two pieces of bread. I mean, this is one of the things about British food, that there's nothing that doesn't taste better between two slices of bread.
But what sort of bread, Chris?
Oh, for that, then obviously just horrible plain white bread.
White.
Plastic bread.
Yeah, with lots of butter as well for extra.
With butter and maybe some, would you put some sauce on there?
You could. Sauce of choice, yeah.
Okay, moving on quickly. Before you all get lost in your reminiscences here, but we're still on pies because Mohammed has come back to say steak and kidney pie. It's really delicious. Mm. I'm not a fan. I don't like kidney or, you know, any of that kind of stuff. So I like steak pie, but not steak and kidney pie. How about you, Chris? Are you a steak and kidney man?
No, like you, I'm not so big on kidney.
Okay. And Palacorn's come back to confirm that, yes, it was a beef mince pie. All I can say is one of my favorites, Palacorn. Great. And okay. Right. Let's move on. Oops, lots of people. Good. Mohammed is a big fan of British food. Yeah. Cornish pasties and baked goods as well. Cornish pasties as well. Ah, good. I feel like it's just my own feeling there. Okay. Right, let's talk about this a little because people who have just joined us may wonder why we're sitting here talking about British food and talking about butties and sarnies and pies. So Sudan's asking, is there any specific national food in the UK? We're here talking about our course, Exploring English Food and Culture, which looks at British food and how multicultural and so on the food is and the history and all the things that go with that. But specific national food, Sally, over to you.
Oh, that's a big question.
If you had to list a few, what would you choose?
Okay. Sunday dinner, which is usually, well, you could have a vegetarian version or a meaty version. So that Sunday dinner could be, in our house, Sunday dinner is roast chicken with roast potatoes, carrots, green beans, stuffing, Yorkshire pudding, and gravy.
Every week? You do that every week?
Well, quite often we do it on a Sunday, yeah, if we're all here, yeah.
That's what Sundays are for.
Yeah.
Do you also have a big breakfast on a Sunday? Does that make like Sunday like, you know, a day of...
That's the only day we eat. No.
Don't need to eat the rest of them.
No, we don't have... Okay, so we don't really have a fried breakfast. We don't really have a full English breakfast, really, ever in our house. But that would, you could say that was another national dish, couldn't you?
Well, let's go over to Tina to talk about the full English breakfast then. And what that is.
I rarely have full English breakfast in Italy because I can't get the ingredients.
How about when you leave Italy? Is it something you try when you go back to the UK?
I've had full English breakfast with you, Tina, in a hotel.
Yeah. No, I love a full English breakfast, but I hardly ever have it. And if I do have it, it's on a special occasion or on a Sunday, and it's sort of brunch. So it's breakfast and lunch because you really don't need anything for many hours after it. And normally so basically full English breakfast, I should say what it is, it's bacon, sausage, eggs, whether fried, scrambled, poached, toast or hash browns, baked beans. If you're really lucky, you might get black pudding, or fried tomatoes or grilled tomatoes. Is that okay. it?
Yep. Mushrooms, yeah.
Mushrooms.
Black pudding might not be lucky for everyone. So I was going to go to Claire and say, you know, we're hearing a lot of meat-heavy meals here. We're not. It's not, you know, all British food is not only about meat. What about, you know, non-meat?
Non-meat items. Yeah, we talk about this in the course as well, don't we, about how there's more and more vegetarians and vegans and how I think we're eating much more healthy these days. Or are we, with all the convenience food around? So I think of British fruit and vegetables as well. Strawberries in the summer, summer fruit, raspberries, blackberries. Those are the things that I miss when I'm away from home.
I'm getting a bit confused about who I'm putting in and putting out here. I'm going to bring Chris back because it's on one of his specialist topics. Primavera is saying...
Honestly, when Tina started listing the ingredients of the breakfast, I just sort of drifted off into a daydream. What are we talking
happiness.
About?
Happiness.
Well, we'll get back to bacon and black pudding, I'm sure. But Primavera is asking, drink milk with tea is weird in our country, but in the UK there are people who drink them together for breakfast. I'd like to talk about that. Not only breakfast, Chris.
Not only breakfast, Primavera, all the time. But you're right that there are lots of countries where it's weird to put milk in tea. But that's I think most people in Britain probably have milk in their tea. Certainly people of my generation, older people, put milk in tea. And all day long. I mean, I drink tea all day. This is I have a cup of tea here that I finished, but this will be my sixth or seventh cup of tea today.
That's impressive.
No, it's lunchtime. That's, you know.
Do you keep up a steady pace all day? Does that mean there'll be like 12 by the end of the day?
Well, the secret is to make tea in a teapot, so that when you make tea, you make a lot of tea.
Okay.
Just keep drinking it steadily, but always with milk. Yeah.
And never with milk for me, just to say I'm one of those maybe rare British people who don't have milk in their tea. I prefer it without.
Okay.
What about you, Tina? Do you have sugar as well? I feel like you're a sugar person.
Who, me? No, I have to have sugar in my coffee. No sugar in my meal, in my tea. But I do quite like lemon tea, you know, a piece of lemon in my tea.
I don't mind that. Or mint.
I love mint. Oh, mint tea. Actually, at the moment, this is going to be a bit disgusting, but I've actually got blackcurrant tea.
Oh. Yeah, no, you were right. That is disgusting.
The tea bag tea.
I've got mint tea. I like herbal teas as well and infusions.
Yeah. Me too.
I don't have milk in my tea either, actually.
I always have milk in my tea. I recently stopped taking sugar in tea and coffee for the first time in my life because COVID has made me larger than I've ever been, you know, from being at home for all this time and drinking too much coffee and tea. So it's amazing how quickly you get used to it. I stopped like 2 weeks ago and I don't miss it at all now.
No, that's good. That's good. And that's quite fast then, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I stopped taking sugar in my tea for 3 or 4 weeks once. And then I thought, what's the point?
It's healthier.
But don't you replace it with the biscuits? So if you don't have sugar, then you eat more biscuits.
I stopped buying biscuits as well. Same. I haven't bought biscuits for almost 2 months now.
Wow.
Claire, have you got any of your biscuits left over from yesterday?
Yep. Yeah. Let's have a look. These are my dark chocolate and cranberry.
Yummy. Nice.
They're quite big. Nice. Yeah.
Okay, moving on to things like that, as we are, I'm going to bring up a question from Kelly, because next Tuesday is a special day. Is it not?
Yes.
It is. Pancake Day.
Oh, yeah, Pancake Day.
We should have rehearsed this, honestly.
It's also another special day. Are we allowed to mention that?
No. Oh, it's Chris's birthday! Woohoo!
But it's Pancake Day. Let's go back to that.
Okay, yeah. Let's focus on the pancakes first. It's slightly more universal. So Kelly's saying, next Tuesday is Pancake Day, and I think we're going to actually have another Facebook Live on Tuesday, are we not? Yes, we are.
Yeah.
We're going to have a Facebook Live on Tuesday, and we're actually going to be cooking pancakes live.
Salad. That sounds like fun.
Yeah.
I think Neil is.
But anyway, Kelly's saying,
I'll be able to use my lemon there then.
You will be using your lemon and some sugar again. But Kelly's saying something that is absolutely true for me. When I try to cook pancakes, the first one is always a disaster. Always with me as well. Herbert, for you.
Yeah, it's supposed to be a disaster.
Yeah, you know that that's going to happen. It's because the pan isn't hot enough.
Yeah.
You never know it's not hot enough until you try. And then the first one doesn't work. Never mind. Put it to one side and the second one will be fine.
Yeah, so the first just get a little drop of the batter in though to see if it's hot enough.
I think all or nothing for me.
Yeah. I did the first pancakes for the dog, basically.
Yeah, you get to eat it yourself, even though it's a bit sloppy and it's just a bunch, like kind of a mound of guns, you get to eat
it. What do you have on your pancake? That's more interesting. Come on, what do you have on the pancake?
Lemon and sugar.
No, but Claire, you've got something that I have on my pancake.
What, this?
Yes!
It's about pancakes!
Oh, it's so nice. It's like maple syrup.
It's better than maple syrup.
What is it?
Golden syrup. It's like maple syrup, but better, in my view.
I would vote for maple syrup being better myself. But
It's thicker, though. Maple syrup's quite runny, isn't it?
This is thicker. Yeah.
Can I just say that while you're all getting excited, or you're all getting very moral about sugar in tea, I don't take sugar in tea because I'm healthy. And now we're getting very excited.
But mine was never a health thing for tea.
Once a year,
Pancake Day. Once a year, isn't it?
Yeah, so and we don't eat pancakes 12 times a day.
But the idea of Pancake Day is to finish off all your fat and sugar before the 40 days of Lent. Is that right?
Okay, I'm going to move on because we have so many questions, and I also want to show some nice videos and clips and things we've got from the course. But some questions very quickly. From Love Earth, what did Shakespeare take for dinner? Did he mention it in his books? We're not going to answer this just now, but I like the question, so I'm going to find out. Shakespeare does mention food in some plays, but yeah, we have a course exploring English Shakespeare, which is running just now, and we'll be talking about that, you know, in a couple of weeks as well. But food, that's an interesting one. Let me find out about that one for you and come back to you. Muhammad Singh, what's special in beef Wellington?
Beef
pastry.
I don't know if any of you do, but
Beef Wellington is like a pie, isn't it?
Is it in kind pastry? Of,
yeah, it's wrapped.
But pastry only on top.
No, it's wrapped all the way around.
It's wrapped in pastry.
It's like a massive pastry. Sausage roll.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. The biggest sausage roll you've ever seen in your life.
I've made it with with a vegetarian version, which is really, really nice. You can make
it. Can I have a recipe?
Yeah.
What in it?
Well, my friend made it with beetroot and called it a beet Wellington. Beetroot and nuts, and I did it without the beetroot, and it was very nice.
See, that's a very British thing right there, a pun.
Yeah.
Isn't it? We love that. That's a very British thing to say. So a word that sounds like another one and make a joke out of it. Chris, I bet you've got a good food pun joke.
Sorry, I was dreaming about breakfast again. Tina has done something terrible by listing all of those breakfast ingredients. What was Sally's pun?
Beef Wellington. Beet Wellington.
Beet Wellington. That sounds horrible.
Okay, no judgment there. Okay, we have a really good question from Atif Elboshi. The first part is easy. The second part, I think, is more difficult and probably really interesting. So let's have a look at it. Atif saying, why is international food found everywhere in Britain, while restaurants that sell British food are not found so much outside Britain? So the first question, I think, on the course, and we can talk about that. Second one, I think, is an interesting one. Who wants to talk about this?
Well, on the... Sorry.
Sally, first.
Chris, go for it.
No, just on the course, we talk about lots of reasons why international food is found in Britain. And we talk about one of the things that makes Britain interesting and an exciting place to go out to restaurants and eat is that you can find food from all over the world in Britain, and not just in London, but all across the country. You'll always find at least one Indian restaurant, what we call Indian restaurants in Britain, Chinese restaurants, but there's food from all over the world is everywhere in the UK.
Let's turn to the second question. British food is true. I mean, you know, you sometimes find British restaurants in places where there's a big concentration of either British people living or a lot of tourism, but not so much as you travel around the world. What would you say, Claire?
Well, because the local food's probably better, I think, is probably the best reason for that, isn't it? I don't know. Or we try the local food and like it so much that we think, oh, it's too hard to get the ingredients for what we need here. The local food's great. We'll eat that.
I think ingredients is a good point there because, you know, where I live, I don't know about where you live, getting the ingredients for lots of traditional British food that I like to make is not easy, is impossible or very difficult. What do you think, Sally? Can you get everything you need where you are?
Actually, not so much nowadays after the changes of political changes in Europe, but there are actually some there's quite a few fish and chip restaurants here in Barcelona, so that's become really popular here. There's a chain, fish and chips.
Is that, you might find a British pub as well, mightn't you?
It's more likely to be pubs that sell, you know, British pubs, British and Irish pubs will sell what we think of as traditional British food.
Okay.
I've got a question about Marmite, by the way.
Did somebody say Marmite?
I'm gonna remove Chris and bring Tina back up in my endless ballet here. At least I would, but I've lost Tina.
I'm glad you brought that jar of Marmite, Claire. I was thinking of bringing mine and I forgot.
It's very precious because, as you say, it's not so easy to get this these days.
Exactly. I stocked up when I went back to Britain.
Okay.
Trying to make it last.
Tina appears to have disappeared, so I won't bring Tina back, but let me bring the Marmite question up.
Yeah, here is a jar of Marmite.
Once I tried Marmite, but I didn't like it. I agree, Carla, absolutely. It was a long time ago. Maybe if I try it now, who knows? I know, it's still horrible. But I'm the only person, I think, here that thinks that. So, Claire?
Doesn't it say something on the jar about love it or hate it? Mm. Or it used to, didn't it? I don't know if it still says that on the jar, Claire.
It doesn't.
Ah, okay. But do you
It says put the oomph in your breakfast.
Okay. So I actually do have Marmite nearly every day for breakfast. Toast.
Every day.
Do you as well? Toast with butter or margarine, and then just a Oh yeah, just a thin layer of Marmite. It's really tasty.
Quite a thick layer I like to have. It's very savoury. It's very salty. So if you're trying it for the first time, you probably just want a little bit on some toast and butter.
Yeah, probably less than you think you want, in fact, because it's just very, very strong, isn't it?
Mm.
It's full of vitamin B12, which is really good for you.
I put it in my cooking a lot, though, as well, don't you? I put it in stews and anything, really, that I'm making, sauces and curries and stuff.
Yeah, gravy.
Tina's back. Okay, so we know that Claire and Sally both have Marmite in their cupboard and are both fans. Chris, Tina, are you the same?
I have got it in the cupboard and lasts for years. But what I was going to say was I put it in the gravy as well sometimes, like you said. But didn't we have a question about gravy too?
We did. But hang on, can I just say about Marmite?
Yes, please.
Before we move on to gravy, the maybe the most useful thing for people who are learning English is we use Marmite to talk about things that you either love or hate now. So you can talk about a person. You know, you might talk about, say, a TV celebrity being a bit Marmite, which means people either love them or hate them. Have you heard Marmite used that way, talking about things being a little bit...
I haven't, actually. You must have your finger on the pulse.
Yeah.
No, I've seen it used that way and heard it used that way a lot. Absolutely. So it can be used as slang to say, yeah, it's a bit Marmite, meaning love it or hate it. Okay, I've got lots to get through, and I've got, you know, things I want to show people about the course and stuff, and we don't have much time left, so let's move on. Tina was just mentioning the question from Carolina Garcia, who's saying, how do you make gravy? What are the original ingredients? So gravy is something that we serve a lot in British food, with roast meat, with roast dinners, like Sally was talking about earlier. It goes into pies and things as well, and stuff like that. And Sally's just showing you the easy way. Who would like to say a little bit about, who would like to start about gravy? And answer Carolina.
I don't know if you can see that.
Sally or Tina, one of you?
I'm not sure about how anyone else does it, but I cut up carrots, the stalks of cauliflower, broccoli, onion, parsnip, any sort of vegetables or the ends of vegetables, and I stick it on the bottom of a oven tray. Then I put a little bit of olive oil over the top of it, salt and pepper, maybe some garlic, and then I cover it with wine.
That's a very Mediterranean gravy. I'm not sure that's what I'd expect with my Sunday
roast. Well, you asked me. That's how I make it.
Mm?
And then and then I put my roast on the top, and then I stick it in the oven.
Okay.
And then by the end of sort of the cooking time, there's no wine left, obviously. Sometimes I do go back in and top it up with some water. And take the roast off the top, give it a whiz with your what's it called? Your sort of blender. What's that thing called?
Hand blender.
Hand blender. And whiz that up a bit. Maybe add some more fluid, liquid or something if you need it.
Mm-hmm.
You can add a bit of flour and water if you want to thicken it, or corn flour and water. And that's me done.
Okay, so we're here. We're finding that there's lots of different ways to make gravy here. That's Tina's way. Sally?
Well, I kind of do it with similar ingredients as Tina.
Your thing again.
So you want to see? I bought this when I went back to England, actually, but I haven't really used that much of it because I normally make gravy with it. Okay, with this, this is a quick way to make gravy. It's gravy granules, and you just put some in a jug, and pour some boiling water in and stir it. And that's your gravy.
So how I would normally do it is I would pour off the juice from meat and add in some stock and some flour.
And a bit
and maybe
of wine.
Something for color, like whether it could be, you know, Worcestershire sauce or you mentioned earlier, Chris mentioned earlier, Marmite or something. How about that? Sally, would you do that?
Yeah, that sounds good. I'd do that. And I'd also, I'd add the water from the vegetables that I'd cooked. Mm-hmm. And a bit of wine.
I use that too.
Yeah. And a bit of wine and a bit of flour.
So the answer to your question, Carolina, is lots of ways.
Can I just say, I'm vegetarian, I make onion gravy with no meat. So vegetable stock, onions cooked for a long time till they're so really soft, with a bit of sugar. Yeah, they're caramelized. And then definitely wine I put in, red wine vinegar as well.
Okay.
Nice. That sounds really nice with those onions. Yes,
I make onion gravy just with the gravy granules that Sally's got. Just make it in the jar. Put some
quicker.
Onion.
It is quicker.
It's good.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about some of the things that we've. Bear with me for 1 second. I just want to find one comment, and I'm going to come back on screen because it's weird not being there and speaking like this.
I quite like him not being there. Thank you.
Yeah, well, that's me decide. That's me decide who's going out next. There we go. Okay. that was nice and simple. No need to think about that one. No, because someone shared a recipe a bit earlier, and I just wanted to pop it up on the screen so that we can talk about our some of the things that are happening on the course. So just stick with me for 2 seconds longer while I scroll through to find.
I'm just looking at Bella talking about having noodles on the table for birthdays. Have you seen that?
Yeah,
I like that. Symbolizing long life.
Okay, so we have a comment here saying, "I'll tell you about a food for dinner, which is called salta. It's a mix of, I guess that's rice, meat, potato, broth, and some pepper. This dish was brought from Turkey. The reason I'm putting that up is." Because
oh, it's so exciting. What's gonna happen?
It is so exciting. I'm gonna have to get rid of somebody else. Okay, there we go. Right. Is because on the course, one of the things we do is exactly that. We talk about we ask people to give lots of different recipes. So Sally and Claire, can you talk about this a little while I about how this works and what we're doing?
Oh, this is just one of my favorite things. On the course, so we're asking people to share a recipe or share some food from their country. So some people are sharing a favorite recipe, they're taking pictures of food that they've cooked, or they're finding a recipe or a picture on the internet and sharing it there. So there's some gnocchi alla Sorrentina, looks amazing. Palestinian falafel is one of my favorites as well. So thank you everyone for sharing that.
I'm going to scroll through this and just tell me to stop when you see one that you'd like to talk about a little. But Sally, have you tried any of the recipes that people
have shared? Look, there's Sally's scone. So somebody's watched the scones video and then made some scones. So that's fantastic.
And an apple crumble.
Oh, yeah, because we've got an apple crumble as well, haven't we? There's tofu and mushrooms. That looks lovely.
And that's from Japan. So you can see there's people from all over the world, from lots of different countries here. Sally, have you tried cooking any of the dishes that people have shared?
I can't remember. I know I've been sort of inspired by them.
I made divorced eggs from Mexico.
Yes, that's a good one. Tell us a little bit about divorced eggs, Claire.
I think it's, pardon my pronunciation, huevos divorciado, and it's there's the lovely red salsa, there's the green avocado, you have beans down the middle in a line, that's the divorcing bit. And then two fried eggs, one on each side. It was absolutely delicious. So I'm going to definitely try something in this course as well, something else.
Mm-hmm. And you could see from that there are hundreds of recipes there. So it's, you know, as Chris said earlier, we're not only talking about British food, but about the food that you eat in your countries as well. And people are sharing all these recipes with people from all over the world.
And we had that fantastic story where somebody put up a recipe on the course. And then they'd never made it, a recipe for bread. And then somebody else on the course made the bread and put a photograph of it on the Padlet.
Oh, yeah.
Talked about it. And that
Somebody's grandma, wasn't it? It was a lovely,
yeah, lovely story. It was a recipe from a gravestone in a cemetery. And they made it. Yeah, that was fantastic. And that's still on the Padlet now. So you can find it there if you join the course or if you're on the course.
And... On the course, we have lots of videos of things like this. I'm just going to show you a couple more. This is one of Tina preparing her apple crumble, but before she prepares it,
okay. So first
obviously, the first thing is to get the apples ready.
Take your apple and peel it. So this is your peeler. Now I get quite a lot of satisfaction if I can do it in one go, but of course you don't need to do that. just to know. Just I can't like you. Nearly there.
Amazing. I can't do that.
No, I can't do that.
Amazing.
I don't think I can do that.
My granddad used to do that with a knife, though, in one go. Every time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me just bring Tina back. And Claire. And
are you going to do it now, Tina? Live?
Yeah. Have you got an apple to hand?
No. But what I did notice, there was a question in the comments. Someone asked about what fruit people grew in the UK. Right. Did you see that?
I'm just going to finish off now by going through a few of the questions really quickly from the audience. So, hold on.
Well, I can just tell you, people grow strawberries, raspberries, blackberries. They have plum trees, apple trees. What else do we have? Apricots? Oh, no, not so much apricots. I have apricots here in Italy.
Mm. Rhubarb, my favourite.
Fruit.
Gooseberries.
Oh, I know, blackcurrant and redcurrant. Mm. They're yummy.
Bilberries,
yeah, we go bilberry picking.
What's a bilberry?
Small, dark. Well, they're black or dark purple berries. They grow in the Peak District in the north of England.
Oh, I've not heard of that before.
Mm, really nice.
It was a loganberry then.
Don't know.
Dwell too long on berries. Chikako Kitagawa is asking a question. I'm going to let each of you just choose one thing, okay? And it can't be the same thing. If I could visit in the UK, what food would you recommend? So what would be your must-try thing? I'm going to start with Claire.
Oh, it's so hard. Afternoon tea with scones and butter and cakes and little sandwiches.
Okay. Cheating a bit because that's lots of things, but okay, that's fine. Chris?
It would have to be fish and chips, I think. For that one thing that everybody knows about British food, I'd say fish and chips.
Okay. Tina?
My mum's roast dinner.
Have you told her?
Is that an invitation?
Everyone's coming.
Let's hope they don't all arrive at the same time then.
Also, Victoria Sponge. You get a good Victoria Sponge, that is ace.
That's definitely two, yeah.
Okay, and Sally, one thing.
Okay. I'd say try some Indian food in the north, probably in the north of England or in London.
I'm gonna be as Scottish as possible and say haggis because everyone should try haggis once in their life. It's delicious.
And once is enough, really. So
I've never had it.
Vegetarian haggis is fantastic. It's really good. It's something I do enjoy. Okay. And I think we're almost ready. I'm just looking through now to see if there's one final question. And if not, then Primavera is just saying, are there special dishes that you prepare for cooking on occasions? This is another topic that we look at on the course.
Yeah.
So the course is free. It's there. The link is in the post here. Join the course and you can find out all about that. Okay.
Can I just say, what have you got for lunch today? Because I'm starving.
I'm really hungry. Lunch, it's way past lunchtime here.
It's almost dinner time.
What are you having, Tina?
I'm not actually sure. I think a wrap with spicy salami and cheese.
That sounds nice.
And yeah, a bit of olive oil.
I live in Slovakia and people have lunch very early here. It's very unusual to have lunch any later than 12 o'clock. So
it's only because of this live that it's really late.
Okay. Last comment from Valentina Borisova. I'm going to have to kick somebody out because I'm going to have to be back.
Me, cook me out. Kick me or cook me out.
I want to go and have my lunch.
I'm going to kick Chris out because his finger went up first.
Look at the Charles Angels.
I forgot to bring myself in.
There we go.
I'm here. Okay. This is a nice comment just to finish with from Valentina Borisova. British food, English food, British food. I'll say British because, of course, England is one country among four in the UK. British food is very special. It's necessary to get accustomed to it. I think that's probably true. especially their big breakfast. That's especially for Chris again. What's in a big breakfast again, Tina?
We haven't got time to go into it now because I need to eat.
It was just purely for Chris's benefit because he loves to hear about bacon and sausages and black pudding again. If you get the taste of it, you'll become its great supporter. I think that's true. I think that's true for lots of things. Would you agree?
Yeah, I think that's what people on the course are saying as well. Because I think it used to have a bad reputation, didn't it, British food? And I think that's changing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to go now. I'm just going to, for people that are not on the course, there we go. That's the name of the course, Exploring English Food and Culture. Yes. No, other way, Sally, other way. Yeah, there we go. Yes, that's good. Okay, Exploring English Food and Culture. As you can see, it's a free course, completely free. All you have to do is follow the link, enter your email address, and join the course. And you won't regret it because it's full of all the wonderful things we've looked at today. Lots of stuff about the UK, also lots of stuff about food from other people's countries, lots of chances to exchange ideas, speak to people from all around the world, communicate. Well worth doing. Okay.
And speak to us.
Sorry?
And speak to us.
That disembodied voice was Tina there. Okay, but it's time for us to go now. So any last words very quickly? I'll go around. Sally.
Thanks for all your questions. And join the course.
Okay. I would like to have got rid of you there, but I've lost you again. Claire?
Please join the course and share recipes. I want something new to cook this time. I'm looking for something really nice. Vegetarian, please. Or cake.
Okay. I accidentally stopped you before you finished there. Chris, final message?
Am I muted? No, I'm not muted. Just thank you for all your questions. We really enjoy answering your questions because it really makes us think about what we eat as well. So if you're not on the course already, join the course, and it's lovely to hear from you.
And Tina.
I get the last word.
Yep.
Do come and join the course. I know everyone has said that already, but it's a fantastic place to learn English, but also to learn other cultures and their food.
Okay, so I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope we see you in the course. And if it's the weekend, I hope you have a great weekend. Bye for now.
Cheers.
Bye. Bye.